So live on this end. How are we going?
She's written a few words. She's got some words.
Is that true?
Thank you. test.
Yes.
Yeah.
complicated world, right?
Looks like you managed.
Is it all right now?
One second. There you go.
Have you got it right there, darling? Right. I was going to bring my office blanket, which is purple, but I thought, oh, I won't need something that heavy.
Definitely.
I was wrong. Vanessa's got a seating plan. We can check with Vanessa's doing. Vanessa, I think Vanessa's panicking about Kevin, to be honest. I think that's what Vanessa's doing.
I am, I'm Jess.
I'm sure you've met before. He's taking names. No? Okay.
Thank you.
Gotcha. Halfway through that, I just remembered the other week, 2 or 3 weeks ago, that in the past, I got a phone call, and there's like, there's a phone on the fire, and the guy. Sorry, it's not funny. Yeah, because it's only two fire as well. I remember that with my profile, that was so long.
Yes, it's quite hot.
I you. And welcome too to those people watching on the screens at home. I hope you feel part of it too. I'm Sue Middlewood, privileged to be facilitating this service for Margaret Ryan. Just a note to say, firstly, the music you will hear today is an eclectic mix of Margaret's favourites. To begin, I shall read a message from Auntie Pam, who is too ill to attend today. I met Margaret when we were in third class at Willara Primary School. We became friends immediately, and thus began 81 years of a loving friendship. As neither family had a phone, notes were sent between Auntie Sylvia and my mother, organising weekends at each other's homes, Margaret at Bondi and me at Willara. In our late teens, we decided we should see more of Australia. Leaving our jobs behind in Sydney, off we flew by DC-3 to Brisbane. Our first stop was an employment agency where we were offered the position of cooks on a sheep farm in Western Queensland. My dear friend, always ready to give anything a go, was about to accept when my hand clamped down on her lap. I pointed out to her it meant cooking 3 hot meals a day for a mob of hungry shearers, which I would not be up to. So the agency then offered us positions as assistants, assistant nurses in a rehabilitation hospital for polio patients at Mount Lofty near Toowoomba. We knew we could be helpful there, so we accepted. After some time, we returned to Sydney, Margaret to a furnishing shop, which provided her with some great ideas for her future home, and also to see the Ryan family, who had a handsome son, Patrick. Fortunately, Margaret's feelings were reciprocated, and that union was blessed with their 4 much-loved daughters, Catherine, Christina, Vanessa, and Madeline. Life then got in our way, and contact was few and far between. But on our reunions, we just picked up where we left off. For some decades now, we have had more time to spend together. And in the past, we have had 2 overseas trips together. One of the many memorable moments of our first trip to Europe was a dinner at the Jules Verne restaurant in the Eiffel Tower. 2 elderly women who had had too many drinks jumped in a cab to head back to their hotel. The taxi driver asked where we were headed, only to be answered with a burst of laughter, as neither of us knew the name or address of the hotel. The cab driver very patiently rattled off a list of names of hotels in La Maris until we recognised the name of ours. I could go on and on about the many wonderful times we had together, but to me, Margaret meant warmth, love, laughter, and a common history. I know how lucky I have been to have had her in my life. And to Margaret, I say, we will meet again. As I said, I feel privileged, especially privileged, like you. I experienced what an amazing woman Margaret was. I first met Margaret when our daughters, my first child, Tony, and her 4th child, Madeline, became school friends. During drop-offs and pick-ups, I quaked in fear that Margaret would see my truth. I was muddling through motherhood, not having much of a clue, while she was the epitome of competence and confidence. Over the many years since then, I have remained Madeline's friend, a and stories of Margaret haven't ceased to impress. Some 6 years ago, I officiated the funeral of Patrick, Margaret's husband and lifelong friend. Now, like then, I feel humbled to be fully immersed in such sacred and significant events in the lives of the Ryan family. Margaret died as she lived, with strength and courage, lovingly cared for by her family, within her own home. This fulfilled her last wishes. Catherine especially enabled this to happen by taking leave, being with her, and using her palliative care nursing skills to ease her passing. Margaret and Patrick's tribe continues to grow. From the four daughters and their partners, Catherine and Ian, Christina and Graham, Vanessa and Kevin, and Madeline and Jeremy, they have 8 grandchildren: Patrick, Nicholas, Matthew, Rachel, Luke, Ben, Ainsley, and Harry. And now we have the beginning of the next generation. The precious great-granddaughter, Layla, and the boy, baby Tim. Margaret is also survived by her beloved siblings, her older sister, Elizabeth, known as Betty, her younger sister, Joan, and her brother, Frederick John, known to the family as John, Uncle John, but friends, Fred. But let's hear more from the people who knew and loved Margaret first, Margaret the most. Firstly, I hope Margaret is hovering above us, because she would be delighted to have our special guest speaker. I'd like to introduce you to the federal member of the ACT, the Honourable Alicia Payne.
Good morning, everyone. It's an amazing honour to be here today to speak about Margaret on behalf of Labor. And the biggest honour is to have known Margaret since I joined Canberra North as a fellow member of the Canberra North sub-branch with her since 2006, and to have had her friendship and support over that time. Margaret was always one of the first people I would call to ask for help or guidance. If we needed something done in the campaigning way, or if I was seeking support to run for something, she was always one of the first people I would ring, and she would always help beyond what you could imagine. She would just get so many things done for Labor. And when I was considering running for federal pre-selection, she was one of a small group of people that I, before I put my hand up, to get their advice, and I really greatly valued Margaret's counsel and guidance. And I hope she knew how much all of those phone calls over the years meant to me. Margaret was a life member of the Labor Party, which is a very special thing, and she had been a member here in Canberra for over 50 years, and I understand a member before moving here in 1971. She exemplified what it means to be a member of the Labor Party. She was deeply committed to social justice, to equality, to progress, and to the things that Labor governments can deliver to make the changes for Australians, to make their lives better. And that was really what drove her, not just about getting people elected, but the things that they can do when they are. That drove her to have be incredibly generous with her time and her efforts, as I mentioned, in campaigning. I hate to think how much letterboxing we had asked Margaret to do over the years for various Labor candidates, but I love to think of all the votes that she would have changed, and also the countless hours she would have spent on pre-poll and on polling day talking to voters, and those critical conversations that she was, of course, brilliant at. She also made a huge contribution to policy debate in our party, and and to holding us to those very ideals and providing ideas on how we should progress them. She was always an active contributor to discussion in the robust discussions we have at Canberra North, and she was a conference delegate every year. She would never hold back from standing up from what she thought was right, and saying that to whoever needed to hear it. Since I was elected, she has talked with me about many policy issues, and even in her final months have written to me about climate change and the environment, social services and the refugee crisis in Afghanistan. I've been really lucky to be a member of Canberra North. It's a fantastic sub-branch that's been inclusive, engaged and a fun place to have meetings, much like a family. There are many Canberra North members here today. And Margaret has been a really important part of making that what it was, that spirit of our branch. Margaret was passionate about party democracy. She really believed in members being able to contribute to those very things I've talked about our policy development. And I think it would be remiss if I didn't say she was fiercely non-factional. But what that, but what that means, and what that meant to Margaret, was that it supported everyone across our party, that you had your say and supported the right members to have their say. And I know that she supported people across the factions in our party. And she always stood up for members having those rights. I also learned this week that she actually ran in a federal Bruce election against Steve Dargable, partly because she wanted there to be a ballot and really knew how important those things were. She was an active member of Emily's List, a group that supports female candidates to have the best shot, and that has been an incredible support. And I know personally how much she has supported me and other women and men across the party. And I see Rachel Stephen-Smith, our Minister for Health, is here too, and she, Margaret, was a huge supporter of Rachel's. That Margaret believed in and how hard she worked is what enables Labor governments to be elected. It's both that work of getting our message out there and that work of creating the policies that get us there that Margaret was a huge contributor to. She's been an enormous inspiration to me and to many others. And I know as I continue my work, as long as I'm a Member of Parliament, I will hold with me those things that she worked so hard for and those things that she believed in, and they will continue to guide me in that. Dear Margaret, we will miss you very much. Rest in peace.
Told, tears and laughter shared. My mother's baby brother confessed she was the bossy one, whilst her big sister confirmed that's how she signed every single birthday card and Christmas card as Love the Bossy Sister. So this is a very brief reflection on Margaret's family life, transcribed at Margaret's direction by her friend Judy. And I've just added a few. So Margaret was born on the 15th of March 1933, the second daughter, a sister 2 years older, Elizabeth, 14 months after Margaret came Joan, and not long after that, a boy, Frederick John. They lived on a dairy farm in rural Echuca. But it was a time of great hardship as Australia sluggishly moved out of the Great Depression. Employment was scarce and hardship severe. The family moved to Bondi, Sydney, For Margaret, those years of childhood in Bondi with her three siblings seemed to me to be an adventure. Margaret's term for the four siblings was the family of Fells. Mother Sylvia, now a single parent, needed to work, and the neighbours kept a lookout for their well-being of the children, also reporting transgressions from time to time. When in grade two primary school, Margaret met a young girl who was to become her lifelong friend, Pam. It was here, somewhere, before the outbreak of the Second War, Margaret and her two sisters found themselves living in a home, being cared for by the government. Every Sunday, their mother would spend what little earnings she had made catching transport out to visit them, to know that they were still loved, that she would be back for them permanently one day. Her mother, Sylvia, known to us family as Sweetie, moved from the family from Bondi and found employment as the Blaxland station manager. Actually, she was the only staff member at the Blaxland train station. Margaret wanted it included here that Sylvia's repeated request for an additional staff member were always denied. When she subsequently resigned from her post, she was replaced by two men. Some of us can relate to that. So Sweetie and Edna Ryan, my paternal grandmother, were to become friends, and from time to time Margaret spent time at the Ryan's home. It was within that family that she met her life's love, Patrick. On finishing school, Pat joined the Merchant Navy and travelled the world. On one memorable occasion, on returning to Sydney from sea, Pat resigned his position and proposed marriage to Margaret, and life took on a new adventure. Pat's management job working for the Ports Authority took them to a number of port towns in Queensland, back to Sydney and back to Brisbane. After 20 years of marriage and constantly moving in 1971, with their daughters Catherine, Christina, Vanessa and Madeline, all under the age of 10, they moved and settled in Canberra, where Pat was employed in the public service, in particular working with shipping and sea policies, predominantly the Lord's Sea, where his contribution led to a notable and highly successful. Margaret recalls the winter of that first year, when Canberra experienced a fortnight of minus 10 degrees each day. A chilly welcome for the family moving from Queensland's quiet climate. I was about four. I essentially remember I never had to wear shoes until moving to Canberra. It was pretty much a shock. So life in Canberra took on its own rhythms, with a home in Ainslie, schooling for the girls, Pat with his career and Margaret as a homemaker. It wasn't too long before Margaret won a scholarship enabling her to undertake a drafting course and to work as an architectural draftsperson for 13 years, retiring in 1989. Now to change the pace, between my sister and I, we have over 100 years of memories to share with our mother, and that's so where do we start? What do we share? What was she like? I could go on. More than once we were forgotten to be collected from a school dance, she'd fallen asleep on the lounge. Or that she never shied from a challenge with her grandchildren. Bobsled, segways, road courses and cycling around Bobnet, starlet. Then there was the backup singing for Dale Braithwaite in a bar in Sydney one night. Apparently when you're an octogenarian, you can do anything. And so the list goes on. But I'm going to share with you that I've been handling my mother's online banking requirements these past few years. My daddy told my mother that Vanessa will look after you when I'm gone, help you pay the bills. So tax time rolls around, and I receive an email from her accountant's new junior, quite possibly still on work experience. Hi, I'm X. Your mother's asked me to contact you, and she said you will have all the receipts for her charity donations as you pay the bills. Mentally not remembering any, I duly click on the online charitable tax donations in the last financial year. He comes back. Your mother's very adamant. Have you checked the account properly? So I had to explain to him my mother's charity business plan. If they are hungry, she would simply buy them a meal. If they were cold, she would buy them hot coffee. We never had spare blankets in the cupboard, often handed out to those who needed them. One cold winter morning, a young man shivering in the shade, begging for change outside the doors in the wind tunnel to the Canberra Centre, our local shopping mall. My mother asked, are you a size medium or large? Large, he whispered. She returned minutes later with the hourly special bike, puffer jacket, sleeping bag, walking suit. Remember, it was a year or two back. Yeah. He was observed months later still wearing that suit. Then technology arrives and people no longer carry cash. A man begging for change outside Coles one morning. I've got my kids this weekend. I have no cereal for their breakfast. My mother explains that at 88, she no longer carries cash. Go get the cereal and I'll meet you at the checkout. The man grabs the cereal and is looking for a self-service checkout. Do they need fruit? She yells across him at the queue. He darts back to get through. Then there are the guys at the traffic lights washing windscreens, all on a first name basis. Hi Margaret, thank you. She wanted everyone to have their human.
My mother gave her children three pieces of advice. Don't marry until you're at least 26. Travel the world first. Have one child and then quit while you're ahead. I married at 22, had three children, and I'm still traveling the world. I guess I didn't follow that advice. My mother was the most generous Christian atheist you would ever meet. She did not believe in formal religion, yet she gave to everyone. It didn't matter who you were or where you came from, she would talk to you and take you in if needed. Margaret also provided us with hours of entertainment with her antics. She had words that were synonymous with her, such as voila, the only French word she could easily remember, and groovy. Clothes were always groovy. She made our clothes and was a great seamstress. Four dresses, same pattern, different colours. Fine if you were the eldest, but as the youngest, I got the three sets of hand-me-downs for what seemed like years. When we were growing up, she would often come out dancing out of the kitchen when a song she liked was on countdown.
Yes, yep.
With four daughters, there were often extras for dinner, often new boyfriends, and she could never remember their names. To be honest, she couldn't remember our names either. It wasn't intentional, but many people asked who Colin was. We didn't know any Colin. And it appeared to be a generic term for new male in the house. I just need to correct Vanessa in my nature. At 84, she came with me and some of my friends to see Daryl Braithwaite at the local pub. Our friend's band was the support act. So pre-show, Daryl was standing in the room over there and I pointed him out. And she goes, oh, that grey-headed man. So we went over for a photo because when you have your white-haired mother with you, you can do anything. So later on, we lost her in the crowd and the pub was packed. Rachel was on GMAR duty and realised she was missing. It shouldn't be too hard to find the white hair in the crowd. Suddenly, the crowd went wild. A white-haired lady up on the stage, tambourine in hand, rocking it out with the band. When she was 85, we bought her a ticket to see the band Queen. As we sat in the arena with about 10,000 other people, she said, there weren't this many people at the last Queen tribute show I went to. It was at that stage I had to explain this was the real Queen. And she loved every minute of that concert. After our father died, we included GMAR in our family holidays. We were fortunate to be able to create some beautiful memories. She was a breeze to travel with, as she happily went anywhere, would eat just about anything and talk to anyone. Spain was where she found her love for sangria and mojitos. This led to a very interesting episode in a very small lift where she kept leaning on the emergency stop button with the bottom and she couldn't work out why the alarm kept going off and we weren't moving. Not what you expect from the mother at 83. Thanks to our mother, we were a family that skied. Margaret had the hot pink ski suit and the garish multicoloured hat.
I've got a photo of that.
With ear flaps all knitted by her mother. We rarely lost our mother on the ski fields. In fact, you could sit in the lodge and spot her from across the car park. Her suit was a one of a kind.
Yep.
As Margaret's health declined, we arranged care through Hammond Care. She thoroughly enjoyed educating each carer in their working rights and giving them any life advice she felt they needed. We would like to thank those carers and the manager Pat who were so supportive to Margaret staying at home towards the end. In the final weeks, when Margaret decided it was time, her eldest daughter Catherine and older sister Betty stepped up and headed the live-in round-the-clock care. This enabled Margaret to have the beautiful death she wanted at home with people she loved. It's never easy to lose someone you love, but I'm thankful to have had my mother for as long as I did. She was able to experience all the major life events you want your parents to share with you. Towards the end, she thanked us a lot for all that we did for her. My response was always, it's a reflection of my upbringing. In the words of Tina Turner, another great old rocker, Mother dear, you were simply the best, better than all the rest.
Thank you.
She didn't want people creeping around being quiet while she died. She wanted loud music, she wanted a party, and I know that's what she wants us to do now. She was grateful for the long life she had and faced the inevitable with great dignity, an example of her ability to be realistic and practical right to the end. I can only describe the last couple of weeks of her life as holding court, as she lay in bed requesting me to summon people to whom she wanted to say goodbye, either in person, by phone or FaceTime. Some of you may be a little surprised for some of the loud music already played today, but I can assure you that these are her choices. My mother really liked loud music with a loud, strong beat. She even knew about heavy metal. She didn't necessarily know the words, so some of her choices might seem somewhat controversial. She just liked the sound. Today, I want to remember my mother's warmth, generosity, niceness, goodness. I have struggled to find the right words. I am finding that words are rather inadequate. My mother was liked by everyone and interacted with everyone in a respectful and authentic way. And although I am her daughter and somewhat biased, I had only ever heard good things said about my mother. My mother said she had a good and very fortunate life. This was said at my parents' 50th wedding anniversary celebrations and many times since. I don't think she had any regrets. As many of you would know, she wasn't afraid to have a go, and she had a go at many, many different things. In her early 40s, and after 20 years of being an at-home wife and becoming a mother of four, and with the youngest still a toddler, my mother enrolled at TAFE and became an architectural draftsperson. Talk about having a go. Despite being told she was too old for a traineeship with the government department, she wouldn't take no for an answer and visited her local member of parliament to ask why she was allowed to do the course but was too old to be allowed to get a job. She subsequently secured a trainee position with the Department of Housing and Construction, where she worked for over 10 years after graduating. She was always involved in the community. It's called volunteering these days. I remember her being in the kindergarten committee, the school committee, various women's lips groups, and for over 30 years, she was advocate, support, and later guardian for Carmen, a local until Carmen's untimely death at 69 last November. Carmen's family called my mother Saint Margaret. There was also the Senior Centre, which she initially joined with her mother. There was the Labor Party, the local homeless people, and recently the Body Corporate Committee at her last home. And there were many other good causes which popped up along the way. Yes, it was her rolling down the hill of Parliament House only 5 years ago in protest on the last fenced off and became inaccessible to the public. She was never one to miss a good protest. One time when I was visiting, I live in Melbourne, I waited outside in the car. We were on the way somewhere. While she went inside to assist a disabled woman to go to the toilet, as her usual support network was not available. She was part of this woman's roster for nearly a week, or it could have been longer, as long as it was necessary, as this woman needed this assistance several times a day. Her incredible involvement in everything in 2001, when she was the recipient of a centenary medal, and the citation reads, "For many years, voluntary work to schools, the disabled, seniors, women, and neighbourhood watch." In 2008, she was the Canberra Senior Centre Volunteer of the Year. My mother was also very practical, or one could say, she was very realistic. four daughters, reportedly spend many sleepless nights worrying when their daughters go out to all hours. Not my mother. She would go to bed and sleep, setting the alarm if she was on pickup duty, apparently not every time. Arguing that if there was an emergency, she would at least be fresh to deal with it. My practical mother was the one who decided it was time to downsize and found a place with north-facing aspect, of course, with easy access to public transport, planning for a future when they couldn't do the maintenance and couldn't drive. And without argument, she gave up her driver's license 2 years ago, the moment she understood that it was unsafe to continue driving. She remained involved and active politically right up to the end. She made phone calls to her local representatives about passive solar house design, amongst other things, just a few weeks ago. I know I haven't said anything about my mother as a mother, but again, words are inadequate, and I don't think I can properly convey how fortunate we have been, how loved and loving she was. Oh, this is not sadly, somebody's got COVID today, make it. Other than that, every one of her descendants has come here today for this celebration. I can't believe she's gone. She is so missed, and that's all I know.
And Christine, would you like to come see? We need to move furniture.
Get a furniture now.
Thank you. Country. She met and married my father Patrick on Gadigal land. She spent the last 51 years of her life here on beautiful Ngunnawal country, where she died peacefully at home 2 weeks ago. Margaret was one of those rare people from our Jing background who could wear yellow. And she wore yellow loudly and proudly. Check out all the photos, folks. A few years ago, I had a bizarre conversation with my mother where she said she didn't feel that she had done much with her life. She was surrounded by astonishing women doing astonishing and accomplished things and somehow didn't include herself in that description. Here goes, folks. Margaret was a life member of ACT Labor. She was widely respected and heavily involved. She staffed every pre-poll booth except for the election that we just had. And when I had to assure her it was okay that she didn't. Margaret was a proud member of the Amalgamated Metal Workers Union, a technical division. She was also a workplace delegate and very active in union politics. Margaret was a licensed builder, a woman back in the late 70s. She was already an architectural draftsperson person working alongside some of the most progressive environmentally conscious architects in Canberra, who all seemed to work for the government at the time building public housing that faced north. Margaret joined the Vintage Reds to maintain her union activism in retirement. It is through them that she outside the court for Bernard Collieri and also attended a number of Extinction Rebellion actions. She had only had a new walker for a matter of days before it was sporting an Extinction Rebellion sticker. Quite a light round thing. Margaret was an active women's liberationist, also joined the Women's Electoral Lobby in January 1973. I think it was January 1973, my answer. Maintained her networks of women for the rest of her life. And it is these networks that have given me my many, many aunties, many of whom are here today. Margaret actively supported Emily's List, attending their regular functions and providing support to their endorsed candidates, including myself at one time. She loved her Emily's List Judy Horacek brooch, which I notice is on top of her today, and wore it on everything. Margaret was also a member of the Older Women's Network, attending their monthly gatherings. She took Kevin's mother Mary along to these as well. Who's that? Margaret was appointed to the ACT Ministerial Advisory Council on Women twice. Once about 15 years ago, and then more recently a few years back, when she sat on the council with my friend Lou from Women with Disabilities ACT. Margaret actively supported many local street people, as we've heard. She would buy the folks coffee or food and stop for a chat. When she found a bicycle in the waste room at her apartment building, she had it fixed up and gave it to Lindsay, the window washer, at Barry Drive. Lindsay was the envy of everyone up at the Ville, which is what everyone calls Ainsley Village. And when he died, there was a facilitated process provided to determine the new owner of the bicycle. I know this because the recipient is one of the street people I stop and chat with, but he doesn't know the history of the bike or that I'm Margaret's daughter. Welcome to North Canberra. I was always asked how my mother was when I'd run into people in the inner north. Everyone knew her. Often I would get reports from people who had seen Margaret and Judy pounding around the streets on their daily 1 hour walk. I figured if you'd seen them walking, then you knew Margaret was doing okay. Margaret and I had a running joke. When people said, oh, you're Christina's mother, she would say, no, Christina is my daughter. She assisted me to attend many things, and I also went along with her to many things. Many things we went to together because they were both our things. So on any given day, I might be her daughter or she might be. Welcome to being Ryan, woman. This year, on her birthday, I took her along to receive her Canberra Gold Award. Last year, on her birthday, we went together to the Women's March for Justice. It was a fantastic day on a slightly warmer, and we saw just about everyone. Later, our Prime Minister told us we were lucky we weren't shot at, and we had a very long, ranty conversation about the dreadful men. Not our first, and not our last, on that topic. Between those two rallies, Margaret and Judy did the big Black Lives Matter march because they were both so angry at the continuing deaths of Aboriginal people in prisons and the removal of children. Heavily masked up with a lot of frowning people because it was the middle of the pandemic. When Labor won the election, Margaret rang me and said, I can live a bit longer now. I assured her that she was not the only one who would have lost the will to live had the ghastly mold been returned. Margaret was a table thumper, a ranter, who didn't put up with unacceptable shit in her space. She famously challenged another dreadful man, Charles Copeland, yes, I'm going to tell the story, when he was ridiculing the Pine Gap peace women who camped on the lawns of Parliament House, 1985, we think it is. She was at a dinner for my father, it was a work dinner for him, I think he was running a fossil fuel division at the time, possibly coal. When Charles Copeland said to the room, you wouldn't even want to rape these women, she asked him if he did want to rape some women. She was very proud of having one of those golden riposte moments right when she needed one, as she'd never felt very good with words. I think every time Charles Copeland did something revolting after that, that he looked around to check for whether my mother was I once asked on Twitter a few years back, what's the most important thing to remember when your mother is coming over? You can imagine all the answers, you know, people have all sorts of things they think they should do when their mother is coming over. The actual answer, the real answer is, make sure you put the champagne in the fridge. When I asked her a few weeks back what was her greatest achievement, she reared up and said, my four daughters. We were having the emergency moment with her at the time. As a committed activist, feminist, social justice and change maker, she's left an enormous legacy. The ripples Margaret has made will continue and continue. I'm terribly proud of who my mother was, what she did with her life, and of what she gave me. I shall miss her, our regular champagnes, and our conversations enormously. But most of all, I will miss her deep, deep friendship.
Julia Ryan is my I'm Julia, Lindell, and I'm speaking on behalf of my sister Lindell as well. Before we go any further, I'd like to read. No, I can't get it out. I was looking to read a message from my cousin Mary, our cousin Mary Ryan in Adelaide, who is, we're very much like to be here today and is following proceedings on the link through the streaming. And she's was very devoted to Margaret and thought she was one of the most important people in our lives. And she was. And she sends her regards to all of us. We were the sisters of Patrick Ryan, Margaret's husband. But Margaret was no run-of-the-mill ordinary sister-in-law, although I don't really know what such a person would be. But we met Margaret in the early 1940s. She was 9 years old. I was five. Baby. That means she became part of our family then, and we don't remember a time when we didn't know Margaret. And you've already heard what an amazing thing it was to know Margaret and how important she became in people's lives. Lindell said Margaret was always there. She was just always there. Margaret married Patrick, our brother, after all the comings and goings you've heard about, at the Garrison Church at the Rocks in Sydney on a cold winter's night, or evening rather, in 1954. And one of the pictures there, because we were all wearing overcoats and hats and felt hats at the time. They moved to Queensland a couple of years after that, and at Rockhampton Cares, Lindell and I were still school and then we university students, and we went on holidays, lovely holidays, up to North Queensland, where Margaret was just a wonderful host. In fact, hospitality was one of Margaret's greatest gifts. She was a fantastic. When I had children, she welcomed me often to Brisbane. We took them on holiday. After she moved to Canberra, Edna, our mother, Patrick's mother-in-law, Edna Ryan, was in the habit of sending any of her important women from the women's electoral lobby to stay with Margaret while they lobbied federal politicians. Margaret's house was regarded as the place where you stay when you had important work to do in Canberra. My son Neil was often embedded in the family when they went on holidays, especially to the snowfields. Lindell took over from Edna and arranged to have her postgraduate students stay with Margaret. From places like Brisbane, Adelaide, the Central Coast, New South Wales, Newcastle and so forth. And so they could research in the National Archives. And some of them stayed several times. They included people like Wendy Patterson, Jennifer Debenham and Kate Borrett. Lindell's colleague at the Newcastle University, James Bennett, stayed over Christmas 1 year and then mid-year to complete his research at the National Library. Margaret was always welcome and very interested in all their research, and she provided a haven for them all. As you've heard, she had a lively interest in social issues, in politics. And in 1972, she joined Canberra Women's Liberation with me and was an enthusiastic participant in all the activities, including street meetings, demonstrations, screen printing workshops for tea towels and underpants, and all of the symbol, of course. Margaret particularly remembered, only recently, she was reminding me of our pro-choice demonstration at Old Parliament House in King's Hall, when we went in with helium balloons under our dresses, pretending to be pregnant. And we tried to get access to the House of Representatives, which was debating an abortion bill at the time. Unfortunately, we didn't make it in there because one of the helium balloons escaped and ended up in the Hyde Park, and there were attendants with boat hooks trying to...
She called them enormous freaks.
Inspired by the women, it was women's movement activities that inspired Margaret to train as an architectural draftsperson, and heard about how she scored a position in the Commonwealth Department of Housing. And she, her union activities were started with the Association of Drafting, Supervisory and Technical Employees, my son informs me, which later became the Metal Workers Union after the amalgamations. But she was extremely active in that union. And in fact, it was through her that I was able to be in on the ground floor of describing the transition from the art of the pen to computer-aided drafting, which of course completely wiped out that profession within a few years. But and we wrote about it as a part of our involvement in technological change affecting women. Once she had retired from there and the four girls had grown up, Margaret expanded her volunteers, which were already huge. She expanded. And she got much more involved with the Labour Party, and we've heard about the Senior Centre for Vintage Room. She also, in more recent years, became joined the University of the Third Age and the Canberra District Historical Society. Her women's movement and commitments included the Older Women's Network, and it's from that that she was a representative on the ACT Chief Minister's Advisory Council. But I have, on a personal note, we sisters are very appreciative, especially appreciative of Margaret's role as a carer from our brother Patrick. Without Margaret, he would have been in a nursing home for some years. But of course, he also had the privilege of being cared for at home. And Margaret Trump, and fitted it in with everything else. Right. Nicholls says Margaret, well, we both say, Margaret was never short of practical advice. Margaret's responsible for the fact that I have a circular rather than an oblong table, which was a very good decision, and I'm pleased with that decision every day. During Nicholls' stay only last month with Margaret, she sought advice about the best kind of shower mat. Margaret recommended the clear plastic bubble mat at Big W. Margaret always knew what was newly available for the princely sum of $12. Lindell purchased one at Newcastle, and it's now known as the Margaret Ryan Memorial Shower Mat. Margaret was an activist to the very end, and that's been mentioned a long time. She was, we couldn't keep her away from her Reclaim the Night March. She demonstrated with the vintage reads about Galeria, as Christine has mentioned. She volunteered only last year on the Historical Society's monthly roster. I wheeled her to her Northside U3A history group only a few weeks ago. The day before she died, she was so pleased to hear that the case against Bernard Collaery had been dropped by the incoming Labor government. It's hard for Lyndall and me to imagine a world without Margaret. She's just been there all our lives. She was always there, practical, down to earth, energetic, caring, a smoother of our paths through life. She leaves a gaping hole, which we don't really expect can ever be filled.
Thank you. Doesn't it? So I'm taking a deep breath.
Just make
Technology.
First, I was instructed to mention two important matters. Right at the very beginning, the number one was how happy I am to see the and to have, quoting her, the government we need and the government we deserve. And she's right. Second, and for the record, she wanted me to inform you that she is opposed to Canberra's second stage cases that is not cost effective. So there we are, we can first one. So, how did my friendship with Margaret come about? I had had the habit for many years of walking in the early morning, and it was on such day as I returned from Margaret met me and asked if she would join me. So began a friendship founded on our shared values, life experiences, and a shared sense of humour. For the past 15 years, Margaret and I walked for about an hour each weekday. We didn't do it on weekends. That was sleepy and tired for some of us. Morning, before breakfast, she always read all the news in the local paper and filled me in as we went along. We love the passing of the seasons, particularly those very cold, mid-Canberra winters. There was a baby magpie which was stranded on the ground. Another of this, said Margaret, she shanghaied a young woman to assist, grabbed a tea towel from the barista and set about rescuing the chick family. But for all of us, we know that her mother. Now's the time to say this act is not different.
As was said a little bit earlier, sometimes the bossy one. She rang me up in response to a phone call that I made, and I got the answering machine as usual, because she was nearly always out, but she eventually got back to us. And I rang her up to tell her that I'd been appointed as one of the people on the Disability Access for Committee for Coffs Harbour Council, to which I told her, and she asked me a few questions as to what we sort of talk about, and so I told her, you know, footpaths and better access around Coffs Harbour for transport, for footpaths, whatever else we needed to talk about, depending on, like, another one was better access to a road in Coffs Harbour down near the jetty, just needed a better ramp, and she said, and don't forget to pour it up on when you need to, which was typical of what she would say. And she was always encouraging to me, and that's just how I remembered her. To me, she was just Auntie Margaret, and I have some wonderful memories, and I always have those. And I thank everybody for. I know who she is, and there's part of me that's missing, but there's a lot of her that lives in my heart, so that's where she is. Thanks, everyone, for coming.
For generations, people over the world have tried to figure out who the GOAT is, greatest of all time. Michael Jordan, Gary Ablett, Ronaldo, Wally Lewis. Well, the answer's pretty obvious. It's been here in Canberra the whole time. That was Grandma, simply the best. Many people saw Grandma as this little old white-haired lady who always wore bright enough clothes to be a traffic controller. She was a caring and giving wife, mother, grandmother, Angry Birds fanatic, and now great-grandmother. What she will forever be remembered for is a staunch supporter of the tram system and its vibrancy it brought to the Canberra landscape. Some will remember her as a lifelong Labor supporter. In 2015, when she became a lifelong member of the Labor Party, to which she then subsequently voted Liberal in the following ACT election. She had a dark side, and she hid this to the world. She's actually the kitten killer from Rockhampton, of Rockhampton. And there was a litter of kittens that family cat had up there, and no one wanted them. So she said, and I quote, "I had no other option but to put them in a bag and drown them." I responded, "Have you heard of the RSPCA?" The look she gave me made me think, thank God I'm not a kitten. In her later days, when she couldn't protest or kill kittens, due to her lack of mobility, she always made herself handy with a cracking story or two. Or just the human GPS, because if you didn't know, it's now 40 zone through the centre of Canberra. You bloody well did know with her in the car. She was shouting at you, nearly giving you a heart attack and making you swerve into oncoming traffic. There's so many superlatives I wanted to use to describe Gemma, but they just aren't justice. Simply one of a kind. Love you, Grandma.
I tried to think of my one big funny defining memory of Grandma, but I kept coming up with all these little things that I really, really loved about her. The way she'd always call a dress a frock, or you'd use marvellous or very impressive as her go-to adjectives. Or the way she'd know pretty much every single species of tree and flower, or how she'd point out the windows of buildings in Melbourne to show that they had been built during the Victorian era. The way she said unexpected gifts and had a 50% success rate and how usable and wanted the gifts actually were. And the time that I wanted a mortar and pestle while I was cooking and she presented me with a mallet and a plastic bag. How you couldn't leave her alone for even a second without her striking up a conversation with a random and learning their life story. And my favourite part about her was whenever I came up from Melbourne, she'd always take me to the Ainsley Football Club because they had a piano there where I could practice. And I was always really excited to show her what I've been working on, and she promised she could hear me from where she was sitting in the pokies. I did not believe her. Despite all the big and wonderful things she did, it's always the little things that I'm going to miss the most.
Now mine actually isn't two pages, it's just size 14 font, so I can read it. Short and sweet, just like Grandma. So just before I start and get into that, I've just got a quick question for my mother. She's probably had about 8.8 mental breakdowns, and I just want to know where the jacarandas are, please. Because grandma, this lady here, would never shut up about them. That was her favourite flower, and I just don't see any. Now, a quick introduction, I'm sure everyone knows, but I'm the fifth, and in my expert opinion, the favourite grandchild. There's many here today who probably haven't seen me since I was probably about this big, but here I stand, 23 years old, that is strong. Years of my adult life was this person's housemate. Now, I guess here we are, Grandma. You had a cracker run, and now you're up here with Grandpa. Watching up over all of us here today, and the closing novel of Mr. and Mrs. Patrick and Margaret Ryan. An 89-year-long novel now over, but the feelings and memories that that novel left us will never be forgotten. Now, we've already actually heard it, but a quick reflection over the last few weeks sums up your extraordinary life. Less than 4 weeks ago, you were kicking strong and said, "That's it, I'm out, I'm going, see you later." And within a week, you left us peacefully in your sleep. I'm sure all of you can agree, and we've already said that, that's how you lived your life. On your terms, and my God, you were stubborn about that. Now, I'm going to keep this short, sweet and bright, just like you were. However, please be patient, because it's so hard to cram so many lovely moments in a few minutes. Now, my goal when writing this, and after talking to all the cousins, was to keep it, you know, to show off my favourite traits about my loving grandmother, and those were her carefree attitude, her selflessness, and a wicked sense of humour. So let's deep dive into your amazing life, and I'll see you all on the other side. Now, Harry just touched on it a little bit earlier, but I've seen this woman right here step out into peak hour traffic on the main street of Dixon without even the thought to look for a... Now, I put this down to the bright yellow jacket of invincibility, but when asked why she didn't look, I was hit with the swift, "I'm old, Luke, they wouldn't dare hit me." Now, that to me is the definition of her carefree attitude. Her selflessness, well, that's an easy one to speak about. Whether it was the decades she looked after her dear late friend Carmen, or the brief moments she stopped in the middle of the road while driving to give to the less fortunate, sometimes even a lift to Angley Village. Mm-hmm. Gma always put others first. I couldn't tell you how many drinks. Now, for those that don't, who are over the age of 40 and don't know what a pre-drinks is, it's where you drink as much alcohol as humanly possible before you go out on the town on a night out. Now, I couldn't tell you how many times this loving woman was always there to hold court at the head of the table, own those pre-drinks, and to lecture us about how, if it's not on, it's just not on. She was always there to express her opinion on you, whether you liked it or not. But if it came down to it, you know, she'd always put herself, you before herself, every single time. That's why we love her. Now, many of you already know this next story, but I will forever hold this one in my memory. I'm sure we all can agree, I scrub up all right, a little bit of a silver tongue, and can definitely be a charmer. Well, I just mentioned the countless pre-drink parties I had at Space Residence, but guess what comes after the pre-drinks and the night out on the town? I'm sure you're all thinking it, the morning after. Now, there's nothing wrong with the morning after, Gma would always say. In fact, it's where many morning after later I've met my lovely partner, 4 years later, and we're still here. Now, back to the story, and I just got to find my spot. My dear housemate had two rules. Those two rules were, no matter what, they would always go out the front door of the ground floor apartment we lived in, and if my housemate was in fact home, I would have to introduce them to her. Now, one Sunday morning, I took the subtle hint to maybe not have as many morning afters. As I was escorting a lovely lady to the front door, picture it, I'm on the home stretch, just past the kitchen. I thought no one was home, and we were ambushed by a short white-haired lady walking out of her room, coincidentally, who did not say hello. She instead led the conversation with, "You're a lot prettier than the one from last week."